Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha TV. You're watching a special report. I'm Rajkamal Rao. In this report, we'll bring to you the provisions of the Benami Transactions Prohibition Amendment Bill 2015, which is pending in Lok Sabha. The Benami law was approved by the Parliament in 1988, but could not be implemented as it did not have certain enabling provisions because of which rules and guidelines could not be framed. Now the government plans to include the empowering sections so that implementation becomes possible. The Benami Transactions Prohibitions Amendment Bill seeks to prohibit holding a property as Benami and restrict the right to recover or transfer property held in Benami. The government proposes to provide a mechanism and procedure for confiscation of property held as Benami.
How you are going to confiscate the property? What are the mechanism which will be involved? And how to check the power that has been given to the officer that can be misused also. So on that provision, the bill is not very, I can say it's silent on that part.
The Benami Transactions Prohibitions Amendment Bill defines Benami transaction as an arrangement where a property is transferred to or held by a person and the money is paid by another person, where the property is held for the direct or indirect benefit of the person providing the money. Any transaction made against a property where the owner of the property denies the knowledge of such property or makes a transaction in a fictitious name is also considered as Benami. All the properties involved in Benami transactions will be considered as Benami properties. No person being a Benamidar is allowed to retransfer the Benami property held by him to the beneficial owner or any other person acting on his behalf. The bill makes all such retransfers as null and void. Those who found guilty of the offences of Benami transactions with rigorous imprisonment up to 7 years and fine which may extend up to 25% of the market value of the property.
Crime. For example, in Prevention of Money Laundering Act, you are attaching the property which is a proceed of crime. When we talk of proceed of crime, we talk of such property which has been derived or obtained as a result of the criminal offence. In Benami transactions, this legislation now, it appears that the initiator who will initiate this, who is considered to be an initiating officer, he may on his own information give and say that there is some property which appears to be Benami and put that person to notice. Now how there may be problem in implementation, it may lead to excesses or arbitrariness, that time will show, but ordinarily I feel that there is a lot of overlapping and there may not be any certainty of the action that may be taken under this act.
The existing Benami law of 1988 does not contain any provision to keep the confiscated property with the central government. The law also lacked empowering authorities with powers of civil court for effective implementation. The act does not have provisions for an appellate mechanism against an action taken by the authority. The bill seeks to strengthen the law through amendments.
By making a provision to allow central government to confiscate Benami properties, government is trying to create a land pool to implement its program on the housing scheme.
The latest economic survey brought a day before the union budget says that India needs 1.88 crores housing units. The same survey has pointed that more than 1.2 crore completed homes are lying vacant in the country. As per 2011 census data, India's households increased by 60 million between 2001 and 2011, and the number of houses went up by 81 million in the same year. This data presented on the floor of the Parliament gave the government a clear picture on the challenge that they have to face in implementing their flagship program, National Urban Housing Scheme.
If one person can invest black money for 1,000 houses, what he does is he buys 1,000 houses and those 1,000 houses are lying vacant. Now, there was an estimate that 50% of the flats are lying vacant or houses are lying vacant. Now we have a situation where people live in small hutments, those unorganized areas and colonies. They don't have sanitation, because the thing is the houses are beyond the reach of people.
An official study conducted by KPMG for the ministry says that by 2022, India needs to develop about 11 crores of housing units to fulfill the housing demand. About 1.7 to 2 lakh crore hectares of land is expected to be required to fulfill urban housing needs by 2012. During this period, India is expected to get investments of more than $2 trillion or about $250 until 2022, of which urban housing is estimated to account for 85 to 90% of the total investments.
Now, the moment this act comes in, what I can project is that suddenly the black market is, the black money holders, they'll have to give up the properties.
Yes.
If the government is going to reclaim all, maybe if not 50%, maybe 20-30% of these flats or houses, they come out. You can see the, what kind of rationalization will come into the prices of houses. So I think this will be another impact.
Experts believe that proposed amendments to the Benami transaction law enable the government to recover unutilized homes registered in Benami names, but they are skeptical about the implementation of the bill.
It's time for us to head into a break. When we come back, we'll tell you about the provisions relating to exemptions provided in the Benami bill.
Properties held in fiduciary capacity by corporate firms are exempted from the provisions of the bill. The bill has also made exemptions to directors and also for the members of Hindu undivided family. The Benami Transactions Preventions Bill exempts properties held in fiduciary capacity from the purview of Benami transactions. Properties held by a member of an undivided Hindu family are also exempted from the purview of the bill. It also exempted properties acquired out of known resources of income by an individual in the name of spouse or child.
Proposed Section 2, Subclass 9, the company has been exempted, director of the company has been exempted. That means the law which is now being made will have no application on such issues which are relating to the company or where the company is holding any property in a fiduciary capacity. This law will not apply to them. This is what it appears to be on the face of it.
The Benami Transactions Prohibitions Amendment Bill 2015 exempts persons or karta of members of Hindu undivided family if the property in question is held by him for the future benefit of the family, where the consideration of property is provided from known financial resources of family. It also exempts persons standing in fiduciary capacity for an individual, a company, a firm, and a body of individuals from the ambit of the bill.
I mean, going further, I'll try to link with the corporate social responsibility scheme, CSR, a lot of money is involved. There may be a chance, there may be a possibility that, you know, some corporates will create a foundation or trust or, you know, what you have been talking about, the employees, employing, purchasing the land or the asset on the part of the company, but there is an understanding. But that is very hard to detect also.
The Benami Transactions Prohibitions Amendment Bill 2015 lays down the processes for penal consequences in the case of a prohibited Benami transaction. According to the proposed law, proceedings for an alleged Benami transactions will be initiated by an initiating officer with the rank of an assistant commissioner or a deputy commissioner defined under the Income Tax Act. The initiating officer will refer the case to the adjudicating authority set up under the proposed bill. The relevant adjudicating authority will pass an order within a specified time after hearing the alleged Benamidar. The beneficial owner or any other interested party, including a banking company and another person who makes a claim in respect of the property. The bill proposes to give powers of a civil court to the adjudicating authority established under the bill.
While there is a citizen is put to strict, loss, or there's lot damage to the citizen in terms of property and all that, the criminal law operates very strictly. You have to construe it very strictly. So 99.99 always such legislations operate prospectively, never ever retrospectively. Okay. So this will have prospective operation. It will not have retrospective operation.
The bill proposes to set up an appellate tribunal to provide appeal against the order of adjudicating authority. After the order of adjudicating authority becomes final, central government will confiscate the properties held as Benami. Confiscated properties are to be managed and disposed of by officers designated by central government. The bill empowers the central government to make rules for the implementation of the provisions of the bill. It has made provisions for central government to designate one or more special courts for the purpose of the bill in consultation with High Court's Chief Justice.
All the matters relating to Benami transactions will now go to an adjudicating authority and an appellate tribunal. Government has also made provisions to authorize an officer to initiate inquiries.
The Benami Transactions Preventions Bill seeks to establish an appellate tribunal which will receive complaints against Benami properties. An initiating officer will be appointed to verify the transactions held in Benami. If the initiating officer believes that the property is held in Benami, he can issue notices to the owner of the property.
Wherever a law has been enforced in such a manner by persons who don't have so much of accountability about their actions, as I am, to be honest to you, I am seeing the implementation of even PMLA. There are streaks of arbitrariness in horrible way in that. Similarly, if you leave the implementation to an inspector or somebody which is unbridled, you are leading definitely yourself to Inspector Raj, and that is why and reason was why FERA was ultimately repealed because of the excess FERA legislation.
We should have provision related to whistleblowing. Anyone, any individual can approach to the authorities, can complain, and everything should be online, on online portal. Maybe one of the, I think this can help. This can help us in reporting the Benami transactions of the properties which are held under the name of the Benami.
The initiating officer will not be able to function. The powers are given to him. He is going to misuse. There is going to be the endless corruption, giving powers in the hands of one individual officer. It's totally unworkable.
The appellate tribunal will look into complaints raised against all Benami properties. The tribunal can initiate an inquiry on the property and can also ask for submission of account books of Benami property that are required for the inquiry. The appointed initiating officer may issue notices to the Benamidar to surrender his property to government. Tribunal will also have the right to impose punishments.
No, that I think my experience tells that, you know, burden on the regular court may not reduce, because in any case supervisory power of the High Court nobody can take away, and supervisory power will always be there. And you see, by and large, the experience with the tribunals, you know, the central government experience with the tribunals has been 50-50. Some of the tribunals have done very well, and some of the tribunals have been totally failure.
The adjudicating officer has the right to confiscate property in case of Benami, and the administrator will have the power to receive and manage property which has been confiscated. Any person aggrieved by the order of adjudicating officer can appeal to the appellate tribunal. Any person aggrieved by appellate tribunal can turn to the High Court. The central government by notification exempt any property relating to charitable and religious trusts from the operations of this act. The central government from time to time issue such orders, instructions or directions to authorities or require any person to furnish information as it may deem fit for the proper administration of the act.
So what is required is more power to investigative agencies, more training, more capacity development, and that cannot be addressed by any bill also. If you introduce any bill, there will be a chance that, you know, that people will find a loophole.
There is another aspect to it, you know. You see, you are completely taking it out from the jurisdiction of the district courts.
Yes.
where the litigant and the lawyers are going to suffer. You cannot do it. It's unconstitutional according to me.
In issuing directions or orders referred in the subsection, central government can have exemptions with regard to territorial area, classes of persons, classes of cases, and any other criteria that may be specified by the central government when rules are framed.
The Benami Transactions Amendment Bill is an extension to Modi's government's political strategy on getting the black money back. The bill aims to curb the black money which is existing in real estate sector.
Arun Jaitley making an announcement while presenting the union budget.
Regard to curbing domestic black money, a new and more comprehensive bill, Benami Transaction Prohibition Bill, will be introduced in the current session of Parliament. The law will enable the confiscation of Benami property and provide for prosecution, thus blocking a major avenue for generation and holding of black money in the form of Benami property, especially in real estate.
With this statement, the government at centre has made it clear that it will act tough on domestic black money holders as well. In an attempt to restrain generation of black money in domestic market, the government has introduced a bill to target Benami transactions in real estate sector.
This is an attempt to synchronize all-round effort into tracking black money, because Indian economy as such over the years, over the decades, has amassed a lot of black money. Now if this black money can be garnered through some measures for positive use to boost up the economy, it would be good.
This is not going to track the black money. You are legalizing the black money which are held by different persons. So to say that you are going to track the black money, that is just a mess. That's not a correct way to put it.
So one of the mandatory provisions of UNCLAC has been a provision for asset recovery and check of the illegal money which has been generated. The government has been talking about black money which is being stashed abroad. But with the pressure of the civil society and academics and the people have been focusing on issues related to domestic black money. So now the UPA has came out with the concept of Benami Transaction Bill, and then now the government has introduced some of the amendments and will be coming out the bill. So it's a welcome step, I can say. It will be helpful in curbing the black money which is being generated in Indian context, or let's say domestic context.
Real estate sector, which does not have any regulator, has become a safe house to save black money, and this has pushed up real estate prices to a level which most of the people cannot afford to buy a home to live in. As per the FICCI study on widening of tax base and tackling black money published in February 2015, the real estate sector in India constitutes about 11% of the GDP, as these transactions involve high transaction value. This has reached up to a point where buyers and sellers both want to transact in cash to evade taxation.
When you go and want to buy a property, say like DLF, if DLF wants to buy a property in its own name, suddenly, the moment the buyer knows that DLF is a buyer, the moment customer, the seller knows that the DLF is a buyer, the prices will suddenly shoot up. So most real estate companies, they will either buy in some individual's name, maybe director, may not be director, and in the technical word they call it aggregators, just to hide their identity so that the prices remain within the limits.
This money has to be tracked down somehow. Why to go out? A black marketer just have to buy a property in the name of a fictitious name, and the money can be parked. Now, if you track black money, now it's a very big discouragement to the people who think that they can just have black money, buy some property and sit tight over it. This will also reflect on other areas in the economy, in the social sector also.
Experts who keep a watch on the real estate sector want the government to place in real estate regulator to restrict people entering to the sector. The real estate sector, which does not have a status of industry, is expected to face shake-up once the act comes into place. Submitting its first report on black money, the special investigation team made some suggestions to the government. It recommended setting up of 5 courts in Mumbai to speed up 5,000 odd pending income tax cases. Further, it sought tax evasion included as a scheduled offence under the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. The team also asked for changes in the Foreign Exchange Management Act to allow authorities to seize and confiscate properties of violators. The last suggestion was to authorize to tally import and export data with foreign governments in order to keep tabs on the trade-based money laundering. The SIT recommended a cap on the maximum cash an individual or an entity is allowed to possess at a particular time.
See, the intention of the government is to track black money. Now, money laundering, despite the act, is something which has not been the government has not been able to control.
The Supreme Court set up the special investigation team on a petition filed by Advocate Ram Jethmalani. It was given the task of investigating unaccounted money that's banked outside India and suggest steps to bring it back to India.
So, it would largely depend upon the manpower who actually are placed in those tribunals. If the people employed with the tribunals are good, so tribunals will work very well. But if the tribunals are only used as a parking lot for the retired people, then of course is a problem, because for a retired man there is no career. There is no career in front of them. So they just come and spend 2 years and go. There is no enthusiasm.
Retired Justice M.B. Shah was appointed as the chairperson. Apart from eminent jurists, the SIT includes Secretary Revenue, Deputy Governor of Reserve Bank of India, Intelligence Bureau Chief, Intelligence Bureau Director, Director of Enforcement Directorate and Director of Central Bureau of Investigation, Chairman of CBDT and the Director of Research and Analysis Wing RAW.
Thank you very much for watching the special report. We will be back with a new issue and new report. Keep watching Rajya Sabha TV.